Okay, so the title of the talks is The Energy Critical Wave Equation, and today's lecture will be organized in two parts. The first part will be an overview of the whole sequence of lectures and kind of putting some perspective into that. And then the second part of today's lecture will be the beginning of the actual work, where I will set up some of the technical tools that will be needed for the rest of the lectures. Okay, so so this talks on the energy critical wave equation are set in the framework of trying to understand global properties of the dynamics of large solutions to nonlinear dispersive equations. So basically, the background to this is an attempt to describe the long-term behavior of large solutions to dispersive equations. And I will start out sort of by the end goal. And this is coming now. So the end goal of these studies are what we call this, what's become known as the soliton resolution conjecture. So that's not really a conjecture, but more of a philosophy. I think it was first noted in the mid-60s explicitly in the work of Zabuski and Kruskal on the correct Debris equation, and it was come to through one of the first attempts at doing computational experiments, and this was one of the big successes, and closely connected to this was the another big success of this story, which is the paper of Fermi Pasta-Ulam, which was in the same direction a bit earlier. So what is this soliton resolution conjecture? And it's the belief that for nonlinear, dispersive, or hyperbolic equations, the long-term asymptotics of solutions are described by what are known as coherent structures. And this is the belief that's been come to be known as the soliton resolution conjecture. So I'll be more specific about this. And I think that to systematically establish this is one of the big challenges in PDE. And what does this conjecture say? Loosely speaking, it says that in order to understand the long-time asymptotics of most hyperbolic and dispersive equations, what you need to know is that asymptotically in time, so there'll be some intermediate regime of times where you cannot say anything, and then eventually the asymptotics resolves into a sum of modulated solitons. So these are traveling waves that are scaled and translated, plus a free radiation term, and that's nothing but the solution of the associated linear problem, plus something that goes to zero. And so somehow it gives a complete description of the long-term asymptotics. So the solutions may behave very strangely and in ways which cannot be described for intermediate times, but eventually there's a simplification. And that's what this is. Okay. So this, as I was saying, this is a conjecture that postulates a simplification. And you have a very complex dynamics, but eventually it simplifies to this superposition of nonlinear objects and linear objects. Okay. So until very recently, the only cases in which such asymptotics could be proved was for integrable equations. So integrable equations are nonlinear dispersive equations that can be reduced to a collection of linear equations. Okay? And examples of this are the correct de Vries equation, the modified correct de Vries equation, the cubic nonlinear Schrödinger equation in one space dimension. And there are not that many more examples. Okay. The other case when such a result had been proved was also in perturbative regimes, where, say, you start from small solutions or from solutions that are already close to a solitary wave, and then you describe what happens. Okay. Now, in 2012 and 13, with Duicaer and Merle, we were able to establish this asymptotic behavior in the specific case of radial solutions of the energy critical wave equation in three space dimensions. Okay. And we did this in two stages. The first one, we proved this decomposition for a well-chosen sequence of times. And in the second stage, we proved it for all sequences of times. And I'll have occasion to discuss the differences as we go on. So let's now get more specific and describe the nonlinear energy critical wave equation. And here it is. We have the usual linear wave equation, and we subtract this nonlinear term with this specific nonlinearity, and we ask that the initial data be in the space H dot 1 of functions with a gradient in L2, and the time derivative is in L2. Okay? And the dimension is 3, 4, 5, 6. I is a time interval, and the origin belongs to this time interval. So one thing I want to point out right away is that this equation, the way we have here, is a focusing equation. We have the minus the Laplacian, which is a positive operator here, and we have minus the nonlinearity. So there's a competition between the linear part and the nonlinear part of the equation, and that results in a focusing effect. Okay. Now, because we're in the energy critical setting, the strength of the Laplacian and of the nonlinearity is the same, and so there's a real competition between the linear part and the nonlinear part. And we will see this more explicitly with formulas in a few minutes. So the first thing is the small data theory. And in these problems, small data yield global solutions, which scatter. So what does scattering mean? We will say that a nonlinear solution scatters if it exists for all large time. And as time tends to, let's say, plus infinity, the solution behaves like a solution of the corresponding linear equation. And we will have a formal definition for that. And I think so the small data theory goes back to pioneering works of Cato, Ginevra and Velo, Pescher, Kapitansky, and several others. Okay. Now there's also an auxiliary space in which we put the solution. It's that norm. This plays the role of a Sobolev embedding in this nonlinear wave equation theory. And I will be more specific of that in the second part of this lecture. It may help you, I mean, certainly helps me, to keep track of these numbers by focusing on the case of 3D. In three dimensions, this is L8. Okay? And in the first lecture, I will treat all dimensions, and then I will be specific to the three-dimensional case so as to avoid these fractions. So why do we call this equation energy critical? And it's because it's critical with respect to the scaling in the energy space. So if we have a solution, U, and we scale it by U of x over lambda, t over lambda, and then we multiply by the correct power of lambda that depends on the nonlinearity, in this case lambda to the minus n minus 2 over 2, then that's also a solution. And this depends on the specific form of the nonlinearity. And the norm of the initial data is independent of this number lambda. So we cannot make it either small or large by moving the scaling parameter. And that's why we call this energy critical. Okay? Cool. The equation is focusing. And it has a, there are two important conservation laws for this equation in the energy space. The first one is the energy, and the second one is the momentum, and we'll discuss that later. But the energy is given by this expression, and you see that there's a competition between the so-called linear part of the energy and the nonlinear part. This one comes with a plus, and this one comes with a minus. Okay. So before going on, I should talk a little bit about the defocusing equation. So in the defocusing critical wave equation, what we do is we change the sign in the nonlinearity. Instead of minus u to the fifth, you put plus u to the fifth. The power 5 is the three-dimensional one. Okay. In that case, then there's no longer a competition between the linear part of the operator and the nonlinear part. They in fact cooperate, and the resulting energy has the plus sign. Okay, so that defocusing equation was studied extensively through the 80s, 90s, and early 2000s, and there's been a tremendous amount of work in that, very important works. Some names I can mention in this connection are Struve, Grilakis, Chatan Struve, Kapitansky, Ginevra Vellon Sofer, and then Bahuri and Gerard, and Bahuri and Chatan. And if you look at the combined results of these people, which took a long time to come through, and there's a big body of work, the end result can be summarized very simply. It says that any large data gives rise to a solution that exists globally in time and which scatters. So the asymptotics is only the asymptotics of the linear equation. So in particular, there's no solitary waves, no traveling waves, and everything just scatters to a linear solution. Okay, so that's the summary. Of course, it took a long time to get to this summary, but today we can just say this is the summary. Okay, so what we're going to do now in these lectures is understand the focusing case, in which the dynamics is considerably more complicated. Okay. So let's go back to the focusing case. The first thing that you notice is that if you forget about the spatial derivatives and just consider the time derivatives and consider functions that just depend on t, we have an easily constructed solution here. This expression is a solution in the three-dimensional case. And at t equals 1, something catastrophic happens, right? It becomes identically plus infinity. Okay, so there's definitely finite breakdown in finite time breakdown. Now you could say, well, but this solution clearly is not in the energy space, right? Certainly not in the energy space, but and the thing is that for wave equations, we have finite speed of propagation. And so if you truncate that solution at time 0, let's say in a box of radius 2, at time 1 in the box of radius 1, it's exactly equal to this solution. And so therefore you have finite energy solutions whose norm tends to infinity in finite time. Okay? And this is what one calls a type 1 blow up. Okay? And by the way, to anticipate some of the things that we will be thinking about and studying, it is still unknown whether type 1 blow up at infinity can occur. That's an open problem. We will see that, at least in the radial case, that cannot happen. Okay? Now, the interesting thing about the energy critical case is that there's not only this type 1 solutions, which arise by ODE, but there's also what we call type 2 solutions. Those are solutions that break down in finite time, but then whose norm remains bounded. And we call those type 2 blow-up solutions. So it's not a very imaginative terminology, but anyway. Also, notice that they're not mutually exclusive, type 1 and type 2. Type 1 means that the limit is infinite. Type 2 means that the supremum is bounded. But it could happen, theoretically, that for one sequence of times you go to infinity and for another sequence of times you remain bounded. That would be mixed asymptotics. And again, in the general, up to infinity, well, this kind of thing is not understood in the general case, but in the radial case, there are no mixed asymptotics in the finite type blow-up. And this is something we will also prove. Okay? Now, the first examples of type 2 solutions were constructed by Krieger, Schlag, and Tataru in the three-dimensional case, then in the four-dimensional case by Hilaire and Raphael, and recently by Gendringe in the five-dimensional case. Okay. I think also in the six-dimensional case. All right. Okay. Let's go on. Now, should we expect soliton resolution for this equation? Okay. So, once you think about this, just a few seconds of thought tells you that it can only happen for solutions that remain bounded in the H1 cross L2 norm, because if you have this decomposition, for linear solutions you clearly have boundedness, and for the soliton part you also have boundedness, because is there rescaled translates of a single function, and so if the soliton resolution is going to hold, you will have to have boundedness. So, to understand soliton resolution for this equation, we restrict ourselves to solutions that are bounded in the energy norm. Okay? And what are some examples of solutions which remain bounded in the energy norm and that exist for all time? Let's start looking at that. I mean, there's a certain zoology of what are the possible objects that arise here. And you like to understand that. So the first thing is scattering solutions. So what are scattering solutions formally? They're solutions for which the final time of existence is infinite, and such that there is some data in H1 cross L2, such that the difference of our nonlinear solution and the linear solution corresponding to this data goes to 0 in H1 cross L2. Okay? And that's what we call scattering solutions. And I'll be more specific about this in the second hour today. Okay? And clearly, for scattering solutions, the H1 cross L2 norm remains bounded, because it is so for the linear equation. Okay. So for any small initial data, as I said, from the local well-posedness theory, we have bounded H1 cross L2 norm. So let's now go to other examples of bounded solutions in the H1 cross L2 norm that exists for all time. And so like before, we forgot about the time, about the space derivatives. Let's forget about the time derivatives now. If you forget about the time derivatives, what you're left is this nonlinear elliptic equation. For n equals 3 is Laplacian of q plus q to the fifth equal to 0. Okay? Of course, we consider non-zero solutions, otherwise it's not so, the zero solution is not so interesting. Now, this nonlinear elliptic equation is an equation with a very long history. It arose in the solution of the Yamabe problem in differential geometry. So this is the work of Oban, Talenti, Shen, and many others. So the Yamabe problem is the problem of whether you have a compact Riemannian manifold in dimension 3, can you make a conformal change of the metric so that the resulting metric is has constant scalar curvature. And it's in the solution of this problem that the study of this equation was very important. Okay. Now we will call this the class of non-zero solutions to this elliptic equation sigma. It's just the name. So what are examples of objects in sigma? The first example, is this guy. So this specific function is a solution to the nonlinear elliptic equation. So we certainly see some features of what the solutions might look like from this. Now, stationary solutions obviously do not scatter. Why? Because if you have a linear solution, and you look at the energy restricted to a fixed set, let's say to the unit cube, and you let that tend to the time tend to infinity, that will always go to zero. That's not difficult to show. And therefore, for static solutions, that's constant, so it will not be going to zero, so they don't scatter. So that's a quick way of seeing that static solutions don't scatter. Now, so we see already this example of a global solution that doesn't scatter. Okay. So this stationary solution has some interesting properties. The first is that up to sine and scaling, this is the only non-zero radial solution to this elliptic problem. And this is a theorem that goes back to the work of Bohorzhayev in the mid-60s, and then Gidas and Nierenberg in the late 70s. Okay? So for radial solutions, we know them. There they are. The other thing, and this is the fundamental work of Gidas and Nierenberg, is that up to translation and scaling, these are the only non-negative solutions. Okay. And this is the so-called moving plane method that proves this. Now, nevertheless, and this is important to us, I think at the time when Ding found this, it was regarded more of as a curiosity, but we will see that this is important to us. There are variable sign non-radial solutions. And they're not just a few, there are many. There's a whole continuum of them. And Dink's construction was functional analytic. And you could see almost nothing about what the solutions looked like from his construction. Then more recently, Delpino, Musso, Paccar, and Pistoia have constructed other examples that are much more hands-on and from which one can read properties. Now our W, I remind you from the previous slide, this W, it had all these characterizations, but it also has variational characterization. If you look at the Sobolev embedding, let's say L6 is contained in gradient in L2 in 3D, with a best constant, the W's realize the best constant. Okay, and that is a result of Oban and Talenti. Although in the radial case, it was already proved by Bliss in the 1920s. Okay. Now, this variational characterization results in the fact that this is the elliptic solution, non-zero elliptic solution with the least amount of energy. And because of this, it's called the ground state. Okay? So in 2008, with Merrill, we established what we call the ground state conjecture for the nonlinear waves equation. And this says that a solution of the nonlinear wave equation, whose energy is strictly below the energy of W, satisfies the following dichotomy. If the gradient is smaller than the gradient of W, then it exists forever and scatters in both time directions and scatters in both time directions. Now, if the gradient is bigger, then it breaks down in finite time in both time directions. And finally, the case of equality here does not arise. There is no such function because of variational consideration. Okay. So the part of the energy space where the energy is smaller than the energy of W, one can understand completely the dynamics. Okay. And then there's a threshold case when the energy equals the energy of W, and this was completely described in a work of Ducayer and Merrill that followed shortly after this one. So in our proof of this ground state conjecture, we obtained this as a result of a method that we developed to study the long-time behavior of solutions to critical dispersive equations. And this method worked in defocusing cases and in focusing cases below the threshold of the ground state. Okay. And this method has become a standard to understand the global in time behavior of solutions below the ground state. Now from the beginning when we applied this to the nonlinear wave equation, we realized that the nonlinear wave equation was very suited to this method. It fit with it very perfectly. And in the back of our minds, it was always the idea that we wanted to eventually see if we could find a model for which to prove soliton resolution. And the fact that this nonlinear wave equation fitted so well with this method made us decide to study it in this case. Okay. So that's how we came to the nonlinear wave equation. I have to say that I have no expertise on wave equations prior to this, but it was kind of forced by what was happening, coming to this. Yeah, I think also Frank didn't particularly have expertise in this direction. We were just exploring. And
no,
Yes. Right. Well, same with me. And so we particularly, it's not that we had decided we're now going to study nonlinear wave equations. It kind of came to us that this was what we needed to do. Okay, so let me now explain what other non-scattering solutions are. You know, these solutions of the nonlinear elliptic equation can be viewed as traveling waves that don't travel, right, whose speed of traveling is zero. Now we are going to go to true traveling wave solutions. Okay. So what are the traveling wave solutions? They're also non-scattering, and they're obtained by doing a Lorentz transformation of the elliptic solutions. So you observe that the nonlinear wave equation is invariant and the Lorentz transformations, and I'll define them in a few minutes. And then you view this elliptic solution as a solution of the evolution equation of the nonlinear wave equation, and then you do the Lorentz transformation to it. And what you end up with is a traveling wave solution. And it has to travel at speed strictly less than the speed of light, so the directions have to have length strictly less than one. Okay? So in our formulation, the speed of light is one. Okay? That's how we're normalizing things. So so these are the traveling wave solutions, and here we explicitly view them as a traveling wave solution in the direction given by L. And this is the formula of what you do to them from the elliptic solution to get the traveling wave solution. Okay? And I'll discuss this a little bit later today, in more detail. Okay. So these are examples of traveling wave solutions, and we will see that it can be proven that these are the only traveling wave solutions. But that is already a result. Okay. So the ultimate goal, as I mentioned, was to establish soliton resolution. And so let's explain what should soliton resolution be for nonlinear wave for the energy critical nonlinear wave equation. So we have a solution whose energy norm remains bounded until the finite time of existence, and you want to show that there's a number j. And elliptic solutions, Qj, directions, Lj, which are sub-speed of light, and that have the property that if you take any sequence of times converging to the final time of existence, which may be finite or infinite, then you can find scaling factors, centers, Xj, and this have to be arranged so that the different solitary waves don't see each other, and that's expressed in terms of this orthogonality of parameters conditions. So we'll get back to that a little bit later on. And a linear solution, which is the radiation term, such that our solution equals this sum of modulated solitary waves plus the radiation term plus an error that goes to zero in the energy norm as the Tn's go to T plus. So this is a very concrete description of what you would like to prove. And the subject of this lecture is to see how far we get into that. Okay. So as I mentioned before, in the radial case, and three dimensions, this has been proved in the work with Ducaire and Merle. In dimensions 3 and 5, this had been proved for the finite time case, u close to w, in the paper also with Ducaire and Merle. And so now I'm just, what I'm going to do in the remaining part of this hour is give you a broad sketch of some of these results and the results that came for later, okay, which are the large data results in the non-radial case, okay? And then the rest of these lectures will be trying to prove these results, okay? And in this part of the series, the aim is to reach up to the radial case. And then in the next part, in end of June, July, is to go to the non-radial case. So I'm leaving the non-radial case for the end as an incentive for you guys to return. Okay. All right. So as I was saying, this decomposition was first proven for a well-chosen sequence of times and then for any sequence of times. And I'll try to explain both methods now. So let me prove the result for all sequence of times. Well, not prove, sketch an argument of how the proof goes, okay? So this was using what we called the channel of energy argument, which is a very powerful argument in this problem. So what the heuristics of what happens as you approach the final time of existence that leads to this soliton resolution is, of course, energy cannot be lost because it's conserved, but the solitons, the sum of solitons has a fixed amount of energy depending on these elliptic solutions. So there has to be some mechanism for which energy disappears. And how can energy disappear? It cannot disappear in size. What happens is that it moves out to infinity. So this soliton resolution phenomenon only holds when you have infinite spatial domain. And what happens is that energy just gets displaced towards infinity, and then in the finite part you just get the soliton parts, and then the radiation part takes care of the energy moving out to infinity. Okay? But of course this is only heuristics, there's no proof in there, so you have to find a way to quantify this and to measure it mathematically. And that's what this channel of energy method does. Okay, so in the radial case, there's a main fact. And the main fact, please don't read this too carefully. Let me summarize it in the following way. Suppose I have a globally defined, for both times, radial solution of the nonlinear wave equation in dimension 3. And suppose I know that this isn't W or minus W or its rescale versions, okay? Then there always has to be, either for positive time or for negative time, energy left outside a light cone for all times. And that's what this says. There's always this lower bound. There's always a block of energy outside these light cones. And this is this energy that is being moved away. Okay? And this is what captures it, this fact. So this is a dynamical characterization of this W, which doesn't move. Okay? For W, it is obvious that this cannot hold. Okay? It's a simple calculation. Because W behaves like 1 over absolute value of x at infinity in space, and then you see that this just fails. All right? So if you're not W, you have this property. Okay, so how do you use this? Okay, first I'm going to tell you how one proves this thing. And here again, don't pay that much attention to the slide. There's a property of solutions, radial solutions of the linear wave equation in three space dimensions that's important here. And this is an elementary property in the sense that I think D'Alembert could have proven it. Okay, so it's a very basic property. And what it says is that if you have a radial solution in the energy space, then either for all positive times or for all negative times, and any number R naught that you choose, there's always some energy left over. So there's a lower bound. Now there is an exception. There's one kind of solution for which this doesn't hold, and that's what corresponds to the Newtonian potential, which is 1 over r, which of course outside the light cone is a proper solution of the energy critical wave equation. Okay, and for that it fails, but what the real mathematical statement is that once you do the orthogonal projection to the complement of the Newtonian potential, then this is true. Okay, so that's the meaning of this statement. Now, how do we use this in the nonlinear problem? The way you use it in the nonlinear problem, so this is a property of linear solutions, but it holds for all R naught. Suppose we have our solution, our global solution that's defined for all times, both positive and negative. I choose an R naught that's very big so that the energy at time zero outside the ball of radius R naught is very small. Okay, I can always do that. It's so small that the small data theory applies. And then the nonlinear solution is close to the corresponding linear solution. And then by finite speed of propagation, the truncation, if I look at it outside that light cone, doesn't affect things. And then I can use the linear result. Okay? And I will give this proof in detail. I mean, this is just I'm just kind of giving you a taste for what we do, all right?
But you have a solution, initial data which are outside of R0.
And then we fill it in so it has to remain small. And
then the influence,
I need some chalk. Oh, I'm sorry. So in here, they're the same.
Yes, so you control what is going on outside the zone. This data nevertheless influence what is going on.
No, because of it just happens there. Yeah, sure. And it gives me the lower bounds that I want are outside the cone. Right? And so it's a cheap trick, but it's a very powerful tool.
But nevertheless, that truncated data influences what is outside of the closing cone.
Yes, but we only care what's outside of this.
You don't care.
No. You see, somehow what goes inside the light cone is unknowable. So we decide that we don't care. And we somehow manage with the information outside. Okay? And this is the point of this strategy. All right? Okay. So then that was only in the radial case in 3D. There's a corresponding inequality that is what we used in this results near the ground state in dimensions 3 and 5. And that's, we take R0 equals 0 then. We can only take R0 equals 0. And then you have the corresponding inequality. And but this, notice that it's claimed only for odd dimensions. Okay. So let me just explain the proof of this result. Let's say in the finite time blow-up, the other case is very similar. Okay. So the first thing is that as the solution is bounded, so it has a weak limit as t tends to 1. And one can show that this weak limit is independent of the sequence of times. You need to give an argument, but that's the case. And then you look at the linear solution with this data at time 1, and that's what the radiation term is. Okay, so that's an easy description in this case of the radiation term. Then, of course, you look at the nonlinear solution with the same data at time equals 1, and that'll be near the linear solution because everything is very nice at time 1 for that solution. So you can use the small data theory at time equals to 1. And now we look at this nonlinear solution, and this nonlinear solution is what we call the regular part of our solution. And what you can see easily from finite speed of propagation is that there's a clean comparison. Outside this truncated inverted cone, the two things are equal. And all the bad action is happening inside the light cone. So I don't know if I can draw another picture. So outside, your solution is very nice. And the whole blow-up is happening from what's happening inside. Okay, that's what you need to understand. Anyway, so we now take, this is the singular part of the solution, and we break it up into blocks. Now these blocks are nonlinear solutions, but they are localized in space-time, and they have certain orthogonality properties with respect to each other, so that you can think of them as independent pieces. And these are what formally the nonlinear profiles associated to a Bahuri-Gerard profile decomposition. Okay, just think of them as blocks. And then there's an error, and this error is small, but only in a weak sense. For instance, you can think of it as tending to zero weakly in the energy space, but not necessarily strongly. Okay. So now what we want to see is that each one of these blocks has to be a W. That's our goal. That's what the soliton resolution says. Okay. So if one of the blocks is not W, we use our dynamical characterization of W, and then there has to be energy here. But there is no energy there because U minus W is concentrated in here. So all of these blocks have to be W. And now all that remains is to prove that the errors term has to go to zero in the energy norm. And for that, we use the second of this outer energy, or well, we can use either one of them. Okay? And that's the end of the proof. Okay, so you have to, of course, to take this with a grain of salt because the proof is rather long, so as we will see towards the end of the week, okay? Or early next week. So now let me explain the other argument, the argument that worked for only one sequence of time. So this argument proceeds in a different way. And the first part of this argument. Let's see here. Is to show that there can't be any energy even near the boundary of the cone. In this region, as you approach the blow-up, as you approach the blow-up time, there can be no energy. So, in fact, that the energy has to be in something like that. Okay. So that's the first part of the argument, and our original proof of this fact used again this outer energy inequalities. Then you combine this with virial identities. What are virial identities? In this context, they're nothing more than the Pohorzhaev identity that was used by Pohorzhaev to show that the only radial solution is W. And there's wave equation analogs, and these are the two analogs. So these are the virial identities. Now we have this formula, and you add them, and you get this very nice fact that the t derivative plus an error is a time derivative. And if you combine that with the fact that the energy is in a region like this, you can conclude, I'm sorry, I seem to have lost myself. Oh, here it was. So what you conclude from this is that this Cesaro means of the time derivative inside the light cone go to zero. Okay, so some average of the... And this is where you need to now pass to a convenient sequence of times. Because of course, because Cesaro means go to zero doesn't mean that the ordinary means go to zero, that the ordinary thing goes to zero, but it means it by a Taverian argument for a subsequence. And that's our subsequence. So this is a very classical argument. Okay, so from Cesaro means to ordinary summability, you go to a subsequence. So for a subsequence, the things have t derivative that goes to zero. If they have t derivatives that goes to zero, it means that each block has to be time independent. But what are the time independent solutions? They're solutions of the elliptic equation. And the elliptic equation solutions in the radial case are W. So now you have a different proof that these blocks are W, but only for a sequence of times. And then you conclude using the weaker of the two outer energy inequalities. Okay. So I'm going to now go to the discussion of the other dimensions and the non-radial case. I will do it rather quickly so that we can then start with the actual detailed proofs and study, okay? So what happened after that? Well, as I mentioned, there's other applications of these techniques, but here, let me first start with a fact that was proved by Kott, myself, and Schlag, and this sort of paralyzed us for a while, and it's the fact that these outer energy inequalities, even the ones with R0 equals 0, are false in even dimensions. Okay, they're just false. You can write down counterexamples. So, okay, it's life. I mean, what can you do? All right. Now the second ones, the ones where R0 is equal to 0, which are the weaker ones, have the following peculiar feature. If the dimension is even, but of the form 4, 8, 12, and so on, they are true for this kind of data. And for the other even dimensions, it's for the opposite kind of data. Okay? It has nothing to do but to accept things, because this is how they are. Okay. Now, for odd dimensions, with Laurie, Liu, and Schlag, we showed that this outer energy inequalities, even with the R0, have an analog which is true in all odd dimensions. But the exceptional functions get to be more and more as your dimension gets larger and larger. So the projection, the orthogonal projection that you have to do is to a space of increasing dimension, and the dimension goes to infinity as the ambient dimension goes to infinity. But the constant is always 1/2. So there's a uniformity in the constant. Okay. So using this fact, my student Casey Rodriguez was able to prove for all odd dimensions the radial case along a well-chosen sequence of times. Now for the even dimensional case, there was a problem because its outer energy inequalities do not hold. And there what we did is we first looked at the case of a related problem, which is the wave map problem. The wave maps are the hyperbolic analogs of harmonic maps. And in this problem, it had been known for a long time that under a certain symmetry assumption called equivariance, there was no self-similar blow-up in the sense described here. And this was proven by integration by parts by Christodoulou and Tavildar Zadeh. But a fundamental ingredient in this proof was that the energy density is non-negative for wave maps. Even though they could be focusing, the energy density doesn't change sign. And now for the nonlinear wave equation in the focusing case, this is a thing that fails completely. And how did you use that the energy density was bigger than or equal to zero? It was to control the so-called flux of the solutions. And it's this control of the flux that allowed for an integration by parts proof of the lack of self-similar behavior. And what we did eventually here is in 4D, with Kott, Laurie, and Schlag, we reversed the analogy between wave maps and a nonlinear wave equation. Usually, you think of the nonlinear wave equation as a simplified model for wave maps, and the wave maps as more complicated. But what we did is instead use the wave maps to prove something for the nonlinear wave equation. Okay, so there's a very simple change of variables under which your solution to the nonlinear wave equation solves something that looks like a wave map equation. And if you look at the corresponding energy, it will be non-negative, the energy density, provided the psi is small enough. And there, then we use the radiation term that shows that on the boundary of the light cone, you have the smallness condition for the U because you have it for the V, and then an iteration argument to go inside the light cone. And you can prove it inside. And then this worked. And the final step was to use this outer energy the inequality with R0 equal to 0 to show that the dispersive term goes to 0. And here in the four-dimensional case, the data for which it is true is for the one for which the time derivative is zero. But this virial identity argument gives you that in the error, the time derivative goes to zero. And so that you can plug this in. But then this doesn't work in dimension six because it flips the pairs for which it is true. And then with Howard Jia, who's my postdoc at Chicago, we were able to do this also in all even dimensions by combining two virial identities and not using this channel of energy method. And I'll have occasion to go back to this later. Anyway. So the conclusion of all this is, of course, now for a sequence of times, we have it for all dimensions in the radial case. How about the non-radial case? And the summary of that, which we will see in full in the last lectures, is that for a well-chosen sequence of times, one can also prove this in the non-radial case now. So one has, for a sequence of times, the full soliton resolution for the energy critical wave equation in all dimensions. Okay? So I'll stop with this overview now, and we'll shift gears, and instead of speaking in broad terms, we're going to go to specifics. So now we continue. But instead of continuing, we start. Okay? So this is a restart. We start from the very, very beginning. Okay. So the first part is the local theory of the Cauchy problem for the nonlinear wave. And I will discuss this at some length. So I start out with a linear wave equation, and I will need to draw a picture very soon. So we start with a classical linear wave equation. So we have a linear equation, evolution equation with the right-hand side, initial data and initial derivative data. So there's a general method to solve all such problems, and that's the Fourier method, right? So we take the Fourier transform in space, and then we get ordinary differential equations, and we can solve. Okay, by superposition. So the Fourier method gives you a formula for the solution. So there's the cosine term on W0, the sine term on W1, and what we call the Duhamel term, which is this integral. And we summarize saying that W is the S, which is the linear solution, and the Duhamel term. And the notation I'm using is the hat is the spatial Fourier transform. Okay, so cosine of square root of minus Laplacian t, its meaning is this. On the Fourier side, I just multiply by that. The same for the sine. And this thing means this, and so on. Okay, so this is standard notation. So one of the main properties of the linear wave equation is this finite speed of propagation. So I'm going to draw the picture now. Oh, I'm terrible at drawing. So the finite speed of propagation tells me that if the right-hand side, H, is supported away from this cone, and the data, W, is also supported away from this cone, then in here, the W has to be zero. Okay? That's the finite speed of propagation for the wave equation. In odd dimensions, there's something better, which is the so-called Strong-Huygens principle, which says the following. Let me draw another picture. So, so now the support is contained in here. Then, in all dimensions, well, if this were parallel, in all dimensions the support is contained in here, but in odd dimensions, this is where the support is. Okay? And what's the difference between even and odd dimensions? Okay, so if we're in a three-dimensional space and we see a jet go by, we hear it for a minute and then it disappears and we don't hear it anymore. And that's the three-dimensional case. If we're in two dimensions and we throw a pebble in a pond, we see the ripples all the way out. Okay, so this is nature. So these things will play an important role, as we saw. Okay. So now we start with the local theory of the Cauchy problem for the nonlinear wave equation. And oh, as I'm saying, from now on I will stick to 3D. No more fractions to remember. Well, there will be fractions, but there'll be specific fractions. There will be a four-thirds and a few others coming in. But okay, so this is our nonlinear wave energy critical focusing wave equation. Okay. Now for the study of these equations, there are some important estimates, which in the trade are called Strickard's estimates. Okay, so the Strickard's estimates play the role of the Sobolev estimates. So in the study of wave equations or generally dispersive equations, the Strickard's estimates play the role that the Sobolev estimates play in the study of the Laplacian. Okay, and there's many Strickard's estimates. I'll give you some examples of the ones that we're going to use. Okay. So if you solve, oh, so here I'm talking about the linear wave equation that we had here. So the H refers to this H and the W refers to this pair. Okay. So the first estimate tells me that the soup plus the L8 norm plus the L5, L10 norm, and then the L4 norm of 1/2 derivative, and then this other version of 1/2 derivatives, is controlled in terms of the initial data and the right-hand side. And there's the 4/3. And this fractional derivative, 1/2 derivatives, is imposed to us by the equation. This is the maximum amount of derivatives that you can gain. Okay, so I'm sorry, fractional derivatives appear even though our problem has no fractional derivatives in it. Okay, but that's life. And it's the control of these two space-time norms that we think of as like a Sobolev estimate. Okay. And there's another Strickard's estimate, which I call S sub 2, where on the left you have the same quantity, but on the right, instead of having fractional derivatives, you just have the L1, L2 norm of the H. And this one is obviously easier for some things because there are no fractional derivatives, but sometimes you need to also use the other one. Okay. And because we have fractional derivatives, an important technical tool is, there's some mystery here, this 4 should have been 4/3. Okay. Is this estimate when you apply half a derivative to u to the fifth, it behaves as if it were a true derivative in this chain rule setting. And then there's more of the similar estimates here. Okay. And these are used in the proofs to do fixed point arguments. Okay. So the small data theory is carried out through a fixed point argument. And to do this fixed point argument, it's convenient to use a notation. If I is a time interval, the L8 norm on I, L8 norm in X will be called S of I norm. And the L4 in I, L4 in X norm will be the W norm. Okay. Look, you don't like the notation, I'm sorry. Sometimes we will call the S norm the L5, L10 norm. Okay? That depends on what we're doing at the time. So let me define what I will mean by a solution. A solution on an interval I with 0 in I will be a function which is continuous with values in H1, and its t derivative is continuous with values in L2 in the interior of the interval I. And for all compact subintervals, we will have control of this space-time norms, and the solution will satisfy the integral equation. That's what we will mean by solution. Okay? So it's a standard terminal. By the way, at the end of this first series of lectures, I'll make available to people these notes, okay? But I won't give you the second installment until after the end, for obvious reasons, okay? The main result on the local Cauchy problem is that if there's an arbitrary initial condition, you have a unique solution which is defined on a maximal interval of definition, which we will call I max, and t minus and t plus will be the endpoints of that maximal interval of definition. And to prove this, one uses the contraction principle, which will be, and combine it with the chain rule, to show that if there is a delta naught, that there is a delta naught small enough such that if the S norm of the linear part on that interval is small enough, there is a unique solution on that interval with initial condition u0, u1. Moreover, if we call A this norm on the initial data, we see that the difference between the nonlinear solution and the linear solution has this kind of control. Okay? So that's what I meant earlier when I said that if you are small, then the linear solution is close to the nonlinear solution. And this is the specific estimate. Okay? Now, this gives you a solution in some time interval, and then you want to expand it to get to the maximal interval of existence. And to do that, you have to have a little uniqueness argument that says that if you have an overlap in the time intervals and they agree in the middle, they agree in the union. Okay, so you can do that. And of course, this is for intervals which contain the origin, but we can translate to any time t naught. For instance, I was talking about time 1 earlier. Okay? Now, what's very important for us is something that we call the finite time blow-up scattering criteria. We have to find a way to describe the fact that t plus is the final time of existence. Okay, suppose that one thing that can happen is that the h1 cross l2 norm goes to infinity, that we have time type 1 blow up. But how do we describe type 2 blow up where the norm remains bounded? First, so let me just say in a few words what happens at that time if the norm remains bounded, but you can't continue the solution. What happens is that the gradient squared of your solution is concentrating like a delta mass. And that's why you can't continue continuously. Okay? Now, how do you measure that? And it's this S norm that measures it. If the time of existence is finite, that means that something does blow up, and what blows up is this dispersive norm, the S norm. So the L8 norm becomes infinite. Okay? So if this norm is finite, then T plus is infinite. But more than that, this tells you more than that, it tells you that the solution needs to scatter. So scattering is also described by the S norm is finite. So there's a solution of a linear wave such that this difference goes to zero. Okay, so that's what scattering does, and it's all combined in terms of this assumption. So if this holds, that's equivalent to saying that T plus is plus infinity and the solution scatters. Okay, so it's a good way of codifying that. And, okay, so I'm saying all these things for forward time. You can go backwards and get the same. Then there's one remark that I want to make. The fact that we know that the solutions are constructed by the Picard iteration scheme gives us the finite speed of propagation for the nonlinear problem for free. Because remember that in here, we included the right-hand side in this finite speed of propagation. And so if you define un plus 1 in terms of un, and you know that un has the right support property, you can conclude that un plus 1 has it. And then by the Picard contraction mapping principle, the un plus 1 converges to the solution. So the solution will have the right support property. Okay? And so if support of U0, U1 intersection with a certain ball is empty, then you are outside there. Okay. And you can say the same thing, that if two solutions agree in the ball BX0A, then they'll agree outside the inverted light cone. But of course, for the stronger Huygens principle, you cannot do it. Because things get smeared out by the nonlinearity. So, okay. So I just briefly I want to mention that this notion of solution is one possible notion. There's other notions of solutions that you could have, and they are important. Instead of having the L8 norm, you could ask that the L5, L10 norm be finite, okay? And so the immediate question is this equivalent? Are the two notions equivalent? And the answer is yes. So if you have this property and your equation, you don't need it to be true in the Duhamel sense, but just in the distributional sense, and then you can conclude that you have a solution in the Duhamel sense. Okay. So, but notice that you always have to have these auxiliary spaces. Now, it's a very natural question to know if you know that U is just continuous with values in H1 cross L2 and solves the equation in the distributional sense. Is it a solution in this sense? Okay. Now this is true in dimensions 4 and higher, which was proved by Fabrice Planchon, and it's open in the three-dimensional case. It's actually an interesting open point in the theory. Okay.
Do you expect it to be true?
Yes. Yes. Yes, it should be true. But I don't know how to prove it. Nor does anybody else, as far as I know. Okay. Okay. Why would we want to use this space sometimes? Because when you use this space, you don't need to use fractional derivatives. Okay. The disadvantage it has is that the exponents are different in t and x, and I will show you in a few minutes why that's a problem, or why that may be a problem, and which is why you may want to have both notions of solution. Okay? So the next thing I want to give you is something that is a kind of the furthest that you can go with this local theory of the Cauchy problem. And it's, we call this the long-time perturbation lemma. Okay? And we call it the long-time perturbation lemma because the size of the time interval is not important in the proof of this lemma. Okay? And this is this is one version of it. It's a purely technical thing, but it's an important technical thing, and that's why I'm mentioning it here. Suppose you have an approximate solution. It has finite L5, L10 norm, is continuous with values in H1 cross L2, and it solves this equation with an F. And the F is sufficiently small, and we have U0, U1 sufficiently close to the data for capital U. Oh, by U arrow, I will in general just mean the vector U ddt of U. Okay, it's just a shorthand. So under these conditions, if the epsilon is small enough, this allows you to have a solution to the actual nonlinear problem, which we will call U, which is close to this capital U. And how close it is by an epsilon that's controlled by these things. And this is a very useful tool in this theory. So let me show you what are some results that one can prove using this thing. It's a perturbation argument. There's no quick way of describing it, but it's the one where you use the fact that for the non-homogeneous, for the Duhamel term, you have a wider range of Stricker's exponents.
Okay.
Yes, this I'll go to this. Using this proposition, I think, goes back to the work of Coleander, Keel, Staffilani, Takaoka, and Tao on the energy critical Schrödinger equation. That's where such a result was first specifically formulated. And it was important in their work, and it's important in all of these other works since. Okay.
So the n is independent of the interval.
Yes.
And therefore the epsilon star also is independent of the interval.
Yes, exactly. And that's why it's called long-term perturbation. All right.
But what is it? Is it a 2-page proof?
No. It's a maybe 10-page proof. Okay. And I don't want to give it because, this is a harmonic analysis result. Okay, it's a oscillatory integral result. But of course, I'm not going to give such a very technical thing. So there are other versions of this proposition where instead of the L5, L10 norm, we use the L8 and the W norm. Okay. So what are some consequences of this theorem? First, suppose we start out with a compact set of data. Okay, so we have not just one data, but we take a compact set. Then we can give uniform bounds of the maximal time of existence that just depend, instead of on each individual data, on the compact set. That's the first thing. The second thing is the thing that Gustavo mentioned for continuous dependence. It tells you that if you have some data and a sequence converging to that data, then this sequence all have time of existence as at least as big as the one of this data, and in that interval they converge to the solution. Okay? And I think in the early versions of local well-posedness this was absent. This was an open problem until this kind of version of local well-posedness. Okay? Anyway, all of these results are needed in this theory. Okay. So now I'm going to discuss Lorentz transformations. Remember, we discussed the Lorentz transformations of this elliptic solutions to get traveling wave solutions. Right? That was the previous hour. Okay, so and remember that this depended on this vector L. Now let's take the vector L to be 1, 0, 0. Okay? Pardon me? Yeah. No, there's a factor of little l. So our vector will be little l times E1. Okay? Thank you. Then if you look at what the Lorentz transformation does, it boils down to this. So the x1 variable gets changed to x1 minus lt over square root of 1 minus l squared. The x2 and x3 variables are left untouched. And the time variable gets changed to this. So somehow it mixes space-time, but in this very specific way. And so this is for the linear wave equation. And it's true that if you have a solution of the linear wave equation and you perform this Lorentz transformation, then you still have a solution of the linear wave equation. The question is it still a solution in the energy space? And the answer to that is yes, and it's given by this lemma. And you see that what you have to do is estimate H1 cross L2 norms instead of on parallel hyperplanes on tilted ones, provided the tilting is strictly less than 1. Okay?
But C depends on L.
Yes, and blows up as L goes to 1. Yes, it has to. Okay? But for each S, for each L, there's a C. And this is a very important compactness thing of this family of Lorentz transformations. Now, the proof, if you start to sit down and write the proof, it boils down to the following. If I define V hat by multiplying by the wave group, e to the itxc, this is true. And to prove this, you only have to do Plancherel theorem and then do a change of variables in frequency space. and then this comes out. Okay? So it's elementary if you see it the right way. And also, this is continuous in time in this norm. So for each fixed L, I'll define Y and S this way, which is the inverse of the Lorentz transform that we had before. So to invert this Lorentz transform, you change L into minus L. That's all that you do. Okay, and I write this down here. So now suppose we start with a globally defined solution of the nonlinear wave equation. We can certainly define its Lorentz transform by this formula. By the way, for this is the same formula that I had before that looks so horrible. But when you really write it in coordinates, it's not so horrible. It is very simple. Now, since U is global in time, this is well defined as an element of L8 log. And this is why we used the L8 norm before. Because since the x and the t have the same power, you can do change of variables in space-time norms and see that that gets preserved by the Lorentz transform. And that was the reason why we didn't just work with the L5, L10 norm initially. But we needed these L8 norms because we needed to have the Lorentz transforms. Okay, so it's an unfortunate technical aspect of the theory, but anyway, you can overcome it. So at least you have it as an element of L8 log, but now you have to prove that it's actually in the energy space. And that's a proposition that we prove with Ducayer and Merle, that if U is a global finite energy solution and you do the Lorentz transform, this is also a global finite energy solution. Okay. And the strategy for this proof is somehow truncated on outside cones again. So at the beginning of the theory, we didn't know how to prove this, so we didn't. And then eventually, when we realized that the important thing is what is happening on outside of the cones, then we realized how to prove this. Okay. Okay, so the next part of this introduction goes to the profile decomposition, which is the Bahuri-Gerard profile decomposition. So this is you can think of it as a completely functional analytic thing, a machine. On the other hand, it is not really that, because in concrete cases, you're taking some solution and breaking it up into its blocks of energy and space-time. I mean, so it's both things. So what is this profile decomposition and what does it measure? So these profile decompositions were first studied in elliptic settings, going back to interpretations of Pierre Lillion's work on concentration compactness. There were works by Struve, Patrick Gerard, and Brezis Coron. And it was Brezis and Coron who first noticed that there's a certain orthogonality on the parameters and certain Pythagorean identities that are turned out to be extremely important here. Okay. So, and you can think of this in terms of concentration compactness in these evolution problems, to see these profile decompositions as characterizing the defect of compactness in the embedding given by the Strickert's estimate. So you can think of the L8 norm of the wave equation being controlled by the H1 cross L2. That's an embedding of some kind. And one side has derivatives, the other one doesn't. So you just ask, is this compact? The answer is, of course, not, because there's a group of invariances which is non-compact. How do you describe this defect of compactness? As it's in the terms of this profile decomposition. Of course, that's not the only way to think about it, because what you really think, want to use this for, is to pull solutions apart. Okay. So we start out with any bounded sequence in H1 cross L2. And we start with a bunch of solutions of the linear wave equation and a sequence of parameters. For each j, a sequence in n. And the lambdas are from 0 to infinity, the xj's are in R3, and the tj's are in R. So the xj's and tj's are the space-time centers of this solutions. The lambda j's are the scales for them. Okay, and we say that this sequence is orthogonal if the parameters are such that different solutions don't see each other because of their location or their scaling. Okay. And that's what the meaning of this condition is. Okay. And now we have these solutions UJL, and we say that this is a profile decomposition for this sequence if the parameters are orthogonal, and if we denote UJLN, the scaled and translated UJL, and WJN, the difference between the solution for the U0Ns and this sum of modulated profiles, then this is limit. This is small. And in what sense is it small? Well, first of all, the H1 cross L2 norm is bounded, where these are the time zero expressions. And second, the Strickard's norm of this difference is small as n goes to infinity and then j goes to infinity. Okay? And that's what we mean by saying we have a profile decomposition. This is precisely what I want to say as saying that we have a profile decomposition. Okay? And it takes a while to get used to working with this thing. I have to say, for me, it took years. But anyway, eventually it becomes second nature. You do it enough. Okay. So Bahuri and Girard for n equals 3, and then Boulut for n bigger than 3, proved that for any bounded sequence, you can always extract a subsequence which has a profile decomposition. Okay. And the error, not only the L8 norm goes to 0, but also the L5, L10 norm goes to 0, and the L-infinity, L6 norm goes to 0. Okay, so all of this kind of the Strickard's norms go to 0, but not the H1 cross L2 norm. This need not go to 0. And it's not that you can't prove it, you cannot do it. Okay. And this is one of the reasons why these channels of energy are useful, because this is what we use to show that our errors are actually zero in the stronger sense. Okay? I'm going back to the first part of it.
So that's for any bounded sequence of initial data?
Yes. You can think of it as a sequence in H1 cross L2. You don't have to think of it as an initial data. Of course, you should think of it as an initial data, but it's, so that's why I meant to say that this is a purely functional analytic statement. Okay.
You are writing S squared of t, so therefore they are really taken as initial data.
Right. But of course, if you have a different equation, you could do similar things. All right? Okay, I go on. How are these profiles UJL constructed? They are weak limits of the original sequence. So what do I mean by that? For each J, if I do the reverse scaling and translations on my original sequence, and I take the linear solution with that as data, and I take the weak limit, that gives me the profile at time zero. So what these profiles are all the weak limits of scaled and translated versions of my data to which I apply the solution operator. Okay? The fact that this holds is a consequence of the orthogonality of the parameters and the fact that for each little j less than capital J, this expression, that remember this is the error, goes to zero weakly in H1 cross L2.
I'm sorry, what is this little n arrow? 0, 0? What is
the meaning? Goes weakly to the function 0, 0. N is the parameter that tends to infinity.
Ah, okay, so that's its notation.
Yes. It's nothing conceptual, no.
So you rescale with the... you rescale with some parameter, you translate with some parameters, and then that kills all the other ones.
Yeah, and then, yes. So, if you remember, I said profile decomposition is a sequence with these properties, the parameters have these properties, and the limit goes to zero in this sense. And then for any such thing, you can prove that this limit goes to zero and that this goes to zero weakly. Okay, so these are kind of functional analysis exercises. Okay.
But I'm sorry, there are still these for solutions of the linear problems.
Yeah. I haven't said anything yet. I'm working up there, okay? Now, there's also the important Pythagorean expansions, okay? And these are extremely useful. If you want to look at the energy of your sequence, there's a bar missing there, you can use the energies of the profiles plus the energies of the remainder, and you take the limit as n goes to infinity. And this is true for each capital J. And the same thing is true for the L6 norm. Remember, H1 embeds into L6. That is also true. And from the two things, if you go back to the nonlinear energy, the same is true for the nonlinear energy, because it's true for each one. So there you're already seeing the nonlinear problem. As we will see that by extracting subsequences and changing the profiles possibly, we can always assume that the TJNs are identically zero, or they tend to plus infinity or tend to minus infinity. So this is always the case, and I'll say a little bit more in a minute, okay? Now I just want to make a comment here. It is tempting to think that this Pythagorean expansions also hold, not just for H1 plus L2, but for each one individually. It turns out that to my dismay, this was false. Okay, so there's something where the energy conservation plays a role. And this, you can find the counterexample. But there's alternate versions of those, and I'll just say this very quickly. We separate the profiles into those. Oh, maybe I have to go back. Here I said that we can always assume that either they're identically zero, or they tend to plus infinity or to minus infinity. So the first case we call the index J core, and the second case scattering. It's just terminology, okay? And it turns out that you do have Pythagorean expansions for each individual piece, provided you keep the core terms separate. So you have to keep all the scattering ones together and all the scattering ones together. You cannot break them up, but you can break up the scattering ones. I mean the core ones, I'm sorry. Yep.
Where did the scattering go?
It's in this part. The scattering ones are good enough that you can split them all individually. The core ones are good enough that you can split them. The scattering ones are in here, but they all get added together. They can't be split up. They're there. It's just that I can't separate them. Okay?
I'm still confused. I have the impression that the scattering ones are on the left-hand side, not on the
right-hand
side.
No. On the left-hand side, I have my original sequence. Yeah. On the right-hand side, I have the core and the scattering ones. But I'm piling them. I'm splitting them up differently. The core ones, I can put the sum inside. Okay? No, I don't get rid of anything. It's just how I sum them. Okay? Yeah, so what I would say is that at this point, it becomes interesting to know whether there's some uniqueness in this profile decomposition. Because it could be that that the fact was that you didn't choose it correctly, and that's why you didn't get the right Pythagorean expansions. Okay? So we said that a profile decomposition was a sequence and so on, but why is this the only profile decomposition? Right? You could have two different profile decompositions in principle for the same sequence of times, or for the same sequence of initial data. Now it turns out, so the first part is that if you have a profile decomposition and you change the parameters in this way to lambda tildes, which are just the limits exist and are not are non-zero and so on, and you change the translations and you change the times, and you get new profiles in this way, then this is also a profile decomposition. And that's how we can reduce always to the case when the Tn is identically zero, or Tn over lambda j goes to plus infinity or to minus infinity. So there is this ambiguity, and this is inevitable, okay? But this is an ambiguity that we can understand. And then there's a theorem that says that this is the only ambiguity. Okay? So it's a lemma. If we have two profile decompositions of the same bounded sequence, and there's and they are either both finite or both infinite, then the only way which this could have happened is what was described by the previous lemma. Okay? So there really is uniqueness in the profile decomposition, except for the ones that you can describe by those transformations. And this is something that we prove with Duyckaer and Merle. So this is some precisions on the profile decomposition. Okay. And then the next statement says that if you have a weak limit of the kind that create the profiles, this has to appear as a profile in the profile decomposition. So all weak limits appear as profiles. modulo these transformations. Okay, so it takes a little bit of time to digest this. This is kind of the background. And now in the last few minutes, we will pass to the nonlinear versions of the profiles, which is what you use in nonlinear problems. Okay? And these are the nonlinear profiles. So a nonlinear profile associated to this linear profile is a solution of the nonlinear wave equation, which asymptotically looks like this linear solution. Okay? And of course, these limits after extraction in N, we can always assume exist, because we're admitting negative infinity and plus infinity as part of the limit. So for any sequence after extraction, the limit exists. It's either plus infinity, minus infinity, or finite. Okay. So it's not that hard to see that you always have a unique nonlinear profile associated to a linear profile decomposition. So these guys always exist. And now we rescale them. And one can understand what the time of existence of these nonlinear profiles is because of a simple formula. And these nonlinear profiles are the building blocks for solutions in an approximation theorem. But before, let me just say that this limit, when the lambda j tj n tends to minus infinity, well, then t plus is plus infinity, and when it goes to minus infinity, it's the opposite. So in the cases when you have scattering lambda jn over tjn, that gives you scattering properties for the associated nonlinear profile. And that's why those are called scattering j's. Okay? And then let me just finish today with this approximation theorem that gives you a way. We have a bounded sequence which admits a profile decomposition. Let me take the solutions with this initial data. Suppose that all the associated nonlinear profiles scatter. Okay, so it's one situation. All the associated nonlinear profiles scatter. Then we look at this remainder term, which is the nonlinear solution minus the sum of the modulated nonlinear profiles minus the error, the linear solution corresponding to the dispersive error. Then this difference goes to zero, and the solution un exists for all time and scatter. So we have a way of writing our solution to the nonlinear equation as a superposition of solutions to the nonlinear equation with these nonlinear profiles, plus errors. So this is the easy case when all of these UJs scatter forward. If they don't scatter forward, you can do the same provided you stay away from the final time of existence of the UJs, and provided that uniformly, the space-time norm, the dispersive norm, remains bounded. So this is the way in which these nonlinear profiles are building blocks for the linear, for the nonlinear problem. Okay? And I think I'll stop here, continue next time.
Thank you.
Just a few comments, more questions, more comments. Well, I guess we have new questions due to the talk. So, okay. So So, and what is the okay, I know the answer, but
yes, yeah, it's okay, Frank, it's okay. You can ask so that I clarify, yes?
Okay, so you write everything in dimension 3, but okay, in dimension rate, this typically, this kind of lemma in large dimension are a little more tricky.
They are a little bit more complicated. And the surprising thing that we found out very recently is that some of the Stricker's norms don't work for the errors to go to zero. If you look at the kill tau endpoint and you use that space-time norm, that will not go to zero necessarily. So, you know, you can't use these things like a black box. You have to understand what you're doing.
Okay, very good.
Yeah, so,
yes,
I'm
yeah.
sorry. If you compare this kind of profile decomposition from the elliptic case and the, dispersive case, which are the main differences or the main...
Well, the main difference is that you have a time, right? So, if you want to do this with just the L infinity of L6 norm on the error, then it's basically the elliptic case, okay? But if you want to include these other space-time norms, then you have to include the Stricker's estimates in the proofs.
The key point is the perturbation lemma.
Yes.
Okay, when you have a perturbation lemma, and the other one, you don't have a
perturbation. Yeah, you don't need the perturbation lemma. Yeah, so the perturbation lemma is the fundamental tool to prove this.
I mean, the one you were mentioning.
Yes. That's the fundamental tool to prove this approximation thing. If you ask how to prove this, you have to go back to that perturbation lemma.
But then, is there an analogous to this perturbation lemma in the elliptic case, or it doesn't make a question?
No, it's not needed.
Okay.
Yeah, it's just no. There's no need for that.
Thank you. Okay, very good. Let's thank the speaker again. And